Welcome. Good evening, sir. Good evening, everyone. Today I am here to take a seminar on the topic the emergence of optoelectronics in space technology. First, we'll see what optoelectronics is. As the name defines, optoelectronics can be divided into two different terms, opto and electronics, where opto refers to a light source and electronics refers to the field of science in that deals with the movement of electrons. In optoelectronics, the interaction takes place between the minute particles of light source and the minute particles of electronics. That is, the interaction happens between photon and electron. Optoelectronics is based on quantum mechanical effects of light on electronic materials, especially semiconductors. And it concerns the study and application of electronic devices that source, detect, and control light. Coming on to the term photon, as you can see in the diagram, photon beams are represented. And photon is the smallest discrete amount or quantum. Quantum can be defined as a basic unit. It is the basic unit of electromagnetic radiation, and it is the basic unit of all light. It can be defined as the tiny particle that comprises wave of electromagnetic radiation. Coming on to certain properties of photons, photons are electrically neutral, that is, they carry no charges. Photons are elementary particles. Elementary particles are those particles that have no structure but has certain mass. But unlike other elementary particles, photons doesn't have mass. They have similar properties to electromagnetic waves, that is, they shows both wave nature and particle nature. Each photon has a wavelength and a frequency. Unlike an electromagnetic wave, a photon actually doesn't represent any particular color, and it only corresponds to the color that corresponds to the light of a given color. Photon is one of the rarest particles which is identical to its antiparticle, which we often call the antiphoton. Coming on to photonics, the term photonics, it can be defined as that field of science in which the that deals with the physical science of light. Light in the sense photon, its generation, detection, and manipulation through emission, transmission, modulation, signal processing, switching, amplification, and sensing. The term photonics more specifically connotes the particle properties of light. Being an electromagnetic photons obey the electromagnetic wave properties, that is, it has both particle and wave properties. So the term photonics often connotes the particle properties of light, the potential of creating signal processing device using for device technologies using photons, and the practical applications of optics, about which we will discuss later on, and an analogy to electronics. Analogy actually refers to some kind of comparison towards electronics. History of photons. It was Albert Einstein in 1905 who came up with the concept of photonics. In his explanation of photoelectric effect. In photoelectric effect, he refers photons as discrete energy packets during the transmission of light. But as a field of study, photonics began as a field of study with the invention of laser in 1960 only. Later on, it came into use only in 1980s as the fiber optic data transmission was adopted by the telecommunication network operators, and this term was widely used at the Bell Laboratories. Bell Laboratories usually refers to the Dr. Alexander Graham Bell Laboratories, where he used to do all his experiments and inventions. And in 1980s, An archival journal named the Photonics Technology Letters established by the IEEE Lasers and Electro-Optic Society confirmed the use of the term photons in general. Now we'll discuss about the energy of photons. Energy of photon is a discrete quantity that is determined by the frequency. The diagram represents the energy of photons. The kinetic energy of the emitted electron varies directly with the frequency of the incident light. And in the diagram, the slope represents the kinetic energy, and it is the slope represents the Planck's constant. The point at which electrons began to be emitted from the surface is called the threshold frequency. It is denoted by mu zero. Therefore, threshold frequency is the minimum frequency at which electrons starts to get detected. The kinetic energy of a photon is equal to the kinetic energy of the emitted electron plus the ionization energy. And thus, the energy of a free photon becomes E is equal to h mu, where h mu is the frequency of photon and h becomes the Planck's constant. In the diagram, you can see solid red lines and dotted red lines. In this, the solid red lines represent the kinetic energy of the released electron, while dotted red lines is just a trace back of the linear result to the y-axis. Scope of photonics. Photonics reflects the importance of nature, a photon, nature of light. Photonics and electronics, both of these fields clearly overlap with each other, as electrons often control the flow of photons, and in return, photons also often control the flow of electrons. And scope of electronics is mainly due to its significance in the generation of light of both coherent and incoherent light waves. Then the transmission of light through free space, fibers, image systems, and waveguides. Then the processing of light signals through the process of modulation, switching, amplification, and frequency conversion, and the detection of both coherent and incoherent lights. Photonic communications in general describes the application of photonics or the photonic technologies in communication fields, devices, and systems, such as transmitters, transmission media, receivers, and signal processors. Photonics and optics. Optics is a very familiar term as far as photonics is concerned, since they are very closely related to each other. And photonics is also related to the modern optics, such as quantum optics, optomechanics, electro-optics, optoelectronics, and quantum electronics, while quantum optics often connotes fundamental research, whereas photonics is more into application level, as it is as it connotates the applied research and development field. Photonics is also related to the emerging science of quantum information and quantum optics. Coming on to the term fiber optics or optical fibers, as you see in the diagram, you can see the cross-section of optical fibers. They are long, thin strands of carefully drawn glass about the diameter of a human hair. They are very narrow. These strands are arranged in bundles called the optical cables. You can see the cross-section that consists of glass core, glass cladding, plastic buffer, and outer jacket. Optical fiber is a universal material, and it is used in numerous number of applications, for example, in medicine, data transmission, laser systems, biotechnology, etc. Advantages of photonics and optical fibers. Photonics has a lot of advantages as far as space domain is concerned. And the major advantage of photonics becomes its extremely wide bandwidth, almost unlimited bandwidth, with high carrier frequency and wavelength of 1552.5 nanometer, corresponds to a center frequency of 193.1 terahertz. And consequently, orders of magnitude increase in available transmission bandwidth and larger information capacity. Apart from this, optical fibers are small in size and they are light in weight. As we have discussed earlier, they are three thin strands of drawn glass. Optical fibers are very much immune to electromagnetic interference, and thus there is no EMI crosstalks between the channels. And because of these properties, they are used in high voltage transmission lines, radar systems, power electronic systems, and airborne systems. Availability of very low loss fibers of the order of 0.25 to 0.3 decibel per kilometer, they are used They are used in high performance active and passive photonic components such as tunable lasers, very sensitive photodetectors, couplers, and filters. And low cost systems and optical fibers are also low cost systems for data arrays in excess of gigabytes. Now we'll focus on the role of photonics and optics in space technology. Because of the advantages we have discussed earlier related to the bandwidth, unlimited bandwidth, it has no mass, it has very less power consumption, reduced noise generation, very high beam size, and very much immunity towards electromagnetic interference, and thus there is no crosstalks between the channel and photonic subsystem. They are considered in navigation satellite systems, Earth observation satellites, low Earth orbit, that is LEO constellations, and within telecom satellite payloads. Another important topic is the fiber optic sensing, which is a very important tool used in spacecraft engineering that permits the measurement of temperature, strain, acceleration, and rotation by modulation of some parameter of light propagating inside a fiber. Mechanical flexibility and low weight of fiber optics compared with standard harness is used when articulated systems are used, or many meters of cabling are required, since it is the process. Mass reduction possibilities in case of using photonic system is an important advantage that leads to important cost reduction during handling and launching of the spacecraft. Huge bandwidth and multiplexing properties of fiber optic system is another clear advantage that helps in signal processing, thermal and structure monitoring application, and the use of optical wireless technologies will reduce the cost and time in the assembly and test, that is AIT phase, in the construction of spacecraft. Next is space fiber. Space fiber is a term that is closely related to fiber optical technologies, and it is a multi-gigabytes onboard network technology that is used for spacecraft applications, and it runs over the electrical or fiber optical cable. The picture shows the physical layer testing of space fiber, and the advantages of space fiber is that it improves the data rate by a factor of more than 10, and it reduces the cable mass by a factor of 2. It also provides quality of service and fault detection, isolation and recovery. Fault detection, isolation and recovery, that is FDIR capabilities, that helps in fulfilling wide range of spacecraft onboard communication applications. Space fiber is the successor of space wire protocol, but unlike space wire protocol, space fiber allows 15 times higher data rates per lane, up to 6.25 gigabytes per second and beyond. Coming to the benefits of space fiber to the spacecraft onboard data handling systems, it has very high data rates, as discussed earlier. Then it the reduction of harness mass by 33% and 50% when comparing the mass of a single space wire cable, and the increase in reliability by requiring one network rather than two or three to carry out the necessary onboard communication functions. Then it has straightforward error recovery, which also is the process, and the galvanic isolation improving system. The galvanic isolation is something that improves the system robustness by preventing the fault propagation. Then long distance communication enabling launcher application, to be concerned, where a single network can provide control, monitoring, and video capture function rather than two or three to carry out the necessary onboard communication functions. Next, we'll discuss about the milestone missions and applications on space using the help of photonics and optics. When we start thinking about the milestone missions and applications using photonics and optics in space, there is a key milestone emission that happens in the robustness of photonics, which was the SMOS, soil moisture and ocean salinity satellite that was launched in 2009 by the European Space Agency for the deployment of a 1.55 micrometer fused fiber couplers on a mission critical payload on board. The nominal lifetime of the satellite was 3 years, including a 6 month commissioning phase, but now it has been all more than 10 years. It's almost like 11, 12 years, and still SMOS remains fully operational and it continues to gather information. Then the space-based LIDAR system, about which we will discuss later, telescopes for deep space observation, planetary missions, optical sensors for Earth observation and health structure monitoring, avionic subsystems, laser communication terminals, high-capacity optical inter-satellite link for mega constellations are other milestone applications of photonics and optics in space. Next comes the terabit optical feeder links, high-speed intra-satellite optical interconnects for VHTS. VHTS stands for very high throughput satellites. It helps, it meets the demand on increasing data traffic. And other than that, quantum optical communication system, space-based optical interferometers for the detection of gravitational waves, powers and power systems. Next is flexible RF payloads. Flexible RF payloads consist of the components such as optical amplifiers, then WDM, that is wavelength division multiplexing components, optical modulators, optical switches, and photonic integrated circuits for optical beam forming, switching, and filtering. Coming to its construction, at the core we have of this payloads, we have photons that helps to generate stable local oscillators, which performs optical down conversion and manipulates the optical microwave signals by routing, beam forming, or filtering them in the optical domain. Optical interconnects for digital payloads is another milestone. And the use of low loss optical fibers also allows high density optical interconnects, making use of high density lightweight optical fiber harness and flex foils for the distribution of digital signals within these payloads, giving increased freedom to the system design. Next is the fiber optic sensing for satellite platforms, about which we have discussed earlier. It is used, it is a very important key tool in spacecraft engineering, and it permits the measurement of temperature, strain, acceleration, and rotation by modulation of some parameter of light that is propagating inside a fiber. You know, the optical fiber is based on the phenomena of total internal reflection. The technologies under investigation using the fiber optic sensing method include the fiber Bragg grating, that is FBGs, photonic band gap sensors, in fiber interferometers, that is FOG or accelerometers. Then is photonics for launchers. Optopyrotechnics is a very important topic as far as space application of photonics is concerned, because it is a new approach to the detonation, that is the combustion of pyrotechnics. And in this method, we use short pulses of lasers for igniting the heating material. The heated material is ignited by short pulses of laser output to produce combustion. This technology has been baselined for the next European launcher, the Ariane 6, whose first flight is planned for April 2022. And you can see the picture of the schematic diagram of Ariane 2022 on the right side. There are many more space missions such as intra-satellite digital communication. Coming to the intra-satellite digital communication, they are based on space fiber, about which we have discussed earlier, and they were launched using the principle of photonics and utilizing its significant properties, and a lot more are yet to launch. Completing our discussion about photonics and optics, now we'll start our discussion about lasers. Lasers stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. It is a device that stimulates atoms or molecules for emission of light at particular wavelengths. And it amplifies that light, typically producing a very narrow beam of radiation. You can see a laser beam on the right side. And the applications of lasers, major applications of lasers include the laser communications, information processing through DVDs and Blu-ray, laser defense systems in space, holographic imaging, laser spectroscopy, about which we will discuss later, laser surgery, gravity wave detection in astronomy, laser material processing. For example, as we all are familiar with this phenomena of gold cutting using laser. Now we'll discuss about what the science behind laser is. As you can see the diagram, there is a diode laser pump. And there is a pump imaging lens, and then we have a high reflector at laser wavelength, in which the high and the high transmission at pump wavelength. Then we have a laser crystal and an optional part, which is a non-linear crystal. Then we have a partially reflecting mirror, and out of which the laser beams comes out. The laser produces a very narrow beam of light in which all of the light waves have similar wavelengths. Mostly lasers are monochromatic. That means they have only lights of a single color. And the laser's light waves travel together with their peaks all lined up or in phase. Lasers have been used in instruments that map the surfaces of planets, moons, and asteroids as far as the space domain is concerned. And scientists have measured the distance between the moon and Earth using lasers, and by measuring the amount of time a laser beam takes to travel to the moon and back, astronomers can tell exactly how far away the moon is from us. Coming on to the type of lasers and their advantages in space, there are basically four categories of lasers. The first is a semiconductor lasers, which is further categorized into edge emitting lasers, EEL, and vertical cavity surface emitting laser, VCSEL. And the advantage of semiconductor lasers include its operation under high current injection. This helps in providing high electrical to optical power conversion efficiency, and semiconductor lasers also have long lifetime and high output. Semiconductor lasers are mainly made out of compounds such as gallium arsenide, indium gallium arsenide, indium phosphide, and indium gallium arsenide phosphate. Then comes the solid state lasers, whose advantages include its high beam quality and the possibility to allow for extra versatility by reaching wavelengths and or output powers. Next categorization is fiber lasers. Fiber lasers has advantages such as high power, cost, low cost, high beam quality, and high efficiency. There are more space relevant improvements happening in the fiber laser technology, such as unattended operation, compactness, low susceptibility to optical misalignment and contamination. And because of their monolithic structure, there is low sensitivity to environmental changes, and thus they are highly reliable. And the relevance in remote sensing and laser altimeters are highly appreciated. Then comes the other three kinds of laser source, which are gas lasers, dye lasers, and chemical lasers. Due to many drawbacks such as short lifetime, less accuracy, and low radiation resistance, they are not used in space technologies. And the next is laser techniques and mission applications in space. The first successful laser application was the Laser Lunar Ranging Experiment that was launched in 9 May 1962. Then comes the Apollo 15 in 1971, in which a flash lamp pumped Q switch rupee laser built, and it was by the Radio Corporation of America, and it was used for the laser altimeter experiment too. Now comes the very important topic, LIDAR. The LIDAR stands for light detection and ranging, and it is a remote sensing method in which the light in the form of a pulsed laser is being utilized. It is used for measuring ranges or variable distances to the Earth, and it helps in determining the Earth's topography, ice sheet, mass, etc. These light pulses, and the light pulses, the light in the form of the pulsed lasers are combined with other data recorded from the airborne system for generation for the generation of precise three-dimensional information about the shape of the Earth and its surface characteristics. A LIDAR instrument principally consists of a laser scanner and a specialized GPS receiver. Coming on to the missions using laser, it was NASA in September 1994 who launched the LIDAR in space technology experiment, that is LITE mission, on the Discovery space shuttle. The early laser geodynamic satellite, that is the LAGEOS NASA mission, which was launched in 1976, was the first satellite dedicated exclusively to high-precision laser ranging, that was followed in 1992 by the LAGEOS 2 by Italian Space Agency. It was also based on the same former LAGEOS design. Then the first diode-pumped solid-state laser, DPSSL, was launched in 1992 that used an NDYAG, that is neodymium-doped yttrium aluminium garnet crystal, that is a solid-state laser. It's a solid-state laser that makes use of this NDYAG crystal as the active medium. And the Balkan experiments launched by Russia in 1995 was also based on the flash lamp pumped NDCRYAG crystals. In 1996-1997, the shuttle laser experiment was introduced, and coming into the Envisat mission launched by the European Space Agency in 2002, it studied the ocean and atmospheric chemical and physical composition, then the Earth's topography and the ice sheet mass, and the other one is the Cloud Aerosol Transport System, CATS mission. It was launched in 2015. And then other one is the European Space Agency's ALOS mission that was launched in 2018. Which then the ICESat-2 mission launched in 2018 by NASA, the Global Ecosystem Dynamics Investigation (GEDI) launched in December 2018, were other prominent latest missions to space using laser. Then in so far we have discussed about the space missions using LIDAR, remote sensing through LIDAR, and now we'll discuss other space missions too. Coming on to the Proba-2 satellite launched by European Space Agency in 2009, it was the first fiber laser that was launched into space within the fiber sensor demonstrator. And then the aim of this mission was to demonstrate the reliability of full fiber optic sensor network in space. The next was the Apollo 15 in 1970. That performed the first topographic mapping of the moon from orbit, and it was extended by Apollo 16 and 17 missions too. Later on in 1994, the Clementine mission, which mapped the surface of the moon over a period of time for more than 2 months, was launched. Then Selene was launched in 2007, which was also known as Kaguya. It was a Japanese mission, and that it orbited the moon for more than 1.5 years, and it survived it with LIDAR technology using the NDYAG laser, which is also a solid state laser. And the pride moment comes to India when the Chandrayaan was launched in 2008, which was the first lunar probe equipped with the lunar laser ranging instrument. That is LLRI, that mapped the it was used for mapping the surface topography using a Q-switched, again, solid-state laser, NDYAG laser at 1064 nanometer with a pulse energy of 100 millijoule and a pulse width of 15 nanosecond. Then the NASA Lunar Orbiter Laser Ultimate, LOLA, in 2008, was launched, and its object one of its objective was was the validation of technologies for the following missions that is going to have that is going to take off to the moon. Next, we have the another important topic, spectroscopy. It is a very common analytical technique that is used to probe the composition of an object. And with the electromagnetic radiation emitted from the body, the resulting spectrum is analyzed to improve the physical properties of that object, particularly such as the age. And these physical properties include the chemical composition, mass, and temperature. And this emitted signal is then amplified, and it is excited and by exciting the target with the energy of a source, the spectroscopy process is being carried out. Spectroscopy can be divided into passive spectroscopy and active spectroscopy. It is commonly used to study astronomical bodies and samples in laboratories. Then comes the science, quantum scientific technologies, and scientific experiments addressing quantum physics challenge have also been launched into space through quantum scientific technology. In this topic, we'll discuss about the atomic clocks and atom interferometers. Atomic clocks based on laser cooled atomic clocks are based on laser cooled atoms, and they are widely used in primary frequency standards, and they are a key component of the Global Navigation Satellite System, that is GNSS. The first cold atom experiment that was launched in 2017 to the space with the matter wave interferometry in the microgravity MIRS 1 mission was another prominent mission based on quantum scientific technology, but unfortunately, it lasted only for 6 minutes. Then, the European Space Agency's Space Optical Clock on ISS, ISOC, Space Optical Clock on ISS mission. It is planned to be launched in 2022, and it will also include an atomic clock that is mainly for fundamental science measurements such as the Earth, Sun, and Moon's gravitational time dilation. Finally, the European Space Agency is also working on the LISA mission that is planned to be launched in 2034 for the detection and accurate measurement of gravitational waves using the so-called laser interferometer space antenna. LISA stands for Laser Interferometer Space Antenna. And in order to test the technology, the LISA Pathfinder mission was launched at the end of 2015 already. With this, we come to the conclusion. And from all the slides we have discussed, we have got an idea that optoelectronics play a key role in the space technology. And the role optics and photonics play together, and if they are to penetrate to the space sector as an enabling technology, it will need to support the transition of the space industry to Space 2.0, while reinforcing the deployment of cost-effective inter-satellite networks and mega constellation. And due to the significant properties of photons we have discussed, including the reduced noise generation and electromagnetic immunity, the satellite operation works closer to the sensor sensitivity bandwidth. They are of a key role in space technology. Since most of the devices currently deployed in space are semiconductor laser diodes or that uses an NDVI laser, as I mentioned earlier, the solid state laser are the active as the active medium, there is a general conservative attitude taken towards the use of laser technology in space application. Thank you.